Let us discuss about the common type of scopes that we use in laparoscopic surgery. So we have a range here, depending upon the diameter. It can be said that this one is 10 diameters, these three. This one is of 5 mm diameter, and the last one is around 2.9 mm in diameter. And then if you talk about the length, this is used for obese patients, especially for the bariatric surgery. So this one, the length from the tip till this part is around 45 centimeters. Then this one has 34 centimeters, again 34, and these two scopes have a length of 30 centimeters. Depending upon the angle of the tip, some scopes have a flat angle like this one. It does not have an angle at the tip, so this is called as a 0 degree. So even if you rotate the scope, the image remains the same, the image does not change. The idea is that you have an end-on view, but you cannot change the view because the view remains the same even if you rotate the camera. So this is especially useful when you are doing a telescopic dissection on TEP patients, when you're going to do extraperitoneal repairs and you're going to dissect the fibers. Surgeons tend to use this scope in those scenarios more. And again, for newer doctors or surgeons, when learning the procedures, this might be a little easier because the assistant doesn't have to rotate the camera, and the error in showing you a wrong angle, that gets negated. But most of the surgeons these days, they tend to train on a 30 degree camera straight away. These ones are the ones with the angle. So if you see, this scope is actually cut at an angle of 30 degrees. You may have 30 degrees or even 45 degrees, but the most commonly used is 30 degrees. And the advantage is that when you have a straight scope, you tend to look a little downwards. And when you want to see sideways, you can just turn your scope, thereby looking at an angle towards the side of the structure. And if you want to look up, you can turn it further. So now you can look up towards the ceiling or the roof or the anterior abdominal wall during your surgery. So where to use which kind of a scope? Well, ideally, we should have the best image possible inside the abdomen. So when you do not have a limitation regarding an incision, you should use a 10 mm scope so that it carries the maximum amount of light that can go inside, and also the bigger diameter of the scope allows you to more light to come back, thereby giving you the best possible image. So 10 mm scope, you see the aperture or the outlet for the light will be much bigger as compared to a 5 mm scope. So these are the tips and they have a outlet for the light. So the 5 mm scope or the smaller scope is going to have a smaller outlet, and it is going to conduct lesser light as compared to a 10 mm. And again, the lens is much bigger in the 10 mm as compared to a 5 mm. And even if you compare to a smaller scope, again, this lens is even smaller and the fiber optics are even smaller. So they're going to conduct less light as we're going to decrease the diameter. And again, the light transmitted back is also less. So the quality of image is going to be inferior for a smaller scope as compared to a bigger scope. So if your procedure demands a high clarity of vision, then you go for a bigger scope. And for a smaller patient, like for pediatric laparoscopic surgeries, when the abdominal cavity is much smaller, the smaller amount of light can give you a better image quality as compared to an adult where the abdominal cavity is much larger and you need a much more light into it. So you can use a smaller scope to give you a better image quality for a smaller patient. Now, the parts of the scope, well, this is the end where you're going to attach the camera head. So this goes towards into the camera head, and make sure you clean the tip very well before you start the procedure, and it has to be cleaned with a dry gauze. So like this, you wipe it off and then have a glance, try to reflect light off the tip of the lens so that you can know if there is any impurities or scratches or if it is wet before you insert it. Similarly, always clean the head of the camera with the sterile gauze going inside. The gauze should be very, very dry. And again, reflect the light off the tip of the glass that is covering the lens and make sure it is absolutely clean before you make this junction. So once it is done, during the procedure, it does not get dirty. So make sure you do it and clean it very well before the surgery begins. So this is the connector for connecting the light cable. And most of the scopes will have at least two adapters with that. So this one goes and attaches over here. And the next one again goes and gets screws and gets screwed over that. This is to connect the different kinds of light cables. So depending on the model that you might have, this particular model is going to connect it on the top of this adapter, but you have a different cable that will get connected once you remove either one adapter, and some of the cables they're going to connect it when you remove the next adapter as well. So the point to note here is that the fiber optic end is quite deep, and as you have more and more adapters over that, like the first one and the second one, it becomes almost impossible to clean the fiber optic end from outside. So when you're cleaning the scope, make sure you remove this outer adapter, reach the end of the fiber optic, clean it well with a gauze, and make sure there is no debris on this. Otherwise, your image quality is going to get deteriorated. At the tip of the scope, again, you make sure you clean it well. There are different ways which I am going to explain, and make sure that nothing is badly stuck on the tip after a procedure which can deteriorate the quality of the image. When we are doing white balancing, well, ensure that the white cloth like this gauze or a pad, it's covering the entire screen of your monitor. What I mean is that just keep your scope at a certain distance and support it with your finger so that it doesn't move, and keep it at a distance so that the gauze is properly focused by rotating the focusing system, and the entire screen is covered by the white gauze. In case it's not covered, like if your scope is much far away, you may include certain areas which are not actually white. Also make sure that you are away from the overhead light which can change the color of your gauze, because it might be yellow in color. Also try to set the light intensity a little lower than 100% so that it's not too bright when you are autofocusing. To decrease fogging during surgery at the tip of the scope, we can use various methods. Like this one, we have a flask filled with saline which is hot. Always keep a gauze piece or a pad at the bottom so that when you're inserting your scope, it does not hit the bottom. So always keep a gauze, and only then you insert the scope into the lukewarm or a little hotter saline. How long do you dip it? Well, that depends upon the room temperature, the conditions of the OR. So with time, you will know that you need to dip it anywhere between 5 to 30 seconds. Apart from that, you can use Savlon or povidone iodine. Just wet your pad, and then with a gentle swipe, you can make the tip of your scope wet. First clean it and then just make it little wet so that it does not fog when you go inside. Apart from that, there are certain anti-fog solutions which are available with various manufacturers which can be used for the similar purpose. Thank you.